Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam amma ba'd. Continuing on in our treatise, in our study of the treatise, Sharh al-Usul al-Thalatha, being Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah ta'ala. And we came to the point in the treatise to the fourth fundamental. The title of the treatise is The Six Fundamentals. Sula Sitta. And as a brief revision, the first foundation or fundamental was Ikhlas, Ikhlas lillah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which has to do with the foundation of Islam and these very important principles which all Muslims should understand and must understand, because these principles come from the Qur'an and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the first principle being Ikhlas lillah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that a person is sincere in their worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that they're sincere in all acts of worship, and that they are directed, all their worship is directed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and that their love should not be shared with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and others, meaning they should have no partners ascribed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything should be purely to please Him subhanahu. And the second fundamental is that the command to unify and the prohibition of dividing into sects and groups. And this is also what is derived from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاَتَّسِمُوا بِحَبْلِ jamian. Jami'an wa la tafarraku, that Allah the Almighty says, and hold or cling all to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all together, and do not divide into groups. And as we explained before, that this hablillah, or the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, refers to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that means we have to adhere to the foundation of the religion and not divide into sects. Instead, refer all of our matters back to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the understanding of the Salaf as-Saleh, meaning the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and those who followed them in righteousness until the Day of Judgment. And the third fundamental that we have already covered was the also which is derived from Kitab wa Sunnah, which is the command to hear and obey the leader. And we discussed that in detail, and that it is not from Islam to protest and have rebellions and to revolt against the leader, regardless of whether that is through speech or whether that is through violent means. So that is not from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to engage in those activities or encourage people to participate in those activities, as it creates animosity and a greater harm to the Muslim society and to the well-being of the Muslims in general. Moving on to the fourth principle, the fourth fundamental. Qala rahimahullah ta'ala, so the Shaykh said, the fourth fundamental is the clarification of knowledge and the scholars, and jurisprudence and the scholars of jurisprudence, and elucidation of those who imitate them but are not from them. So the fourth principle, the fourth foundation, is in fact a clarification of who the scholars are and of what true knowledge is and who the scholars of jurisprudence are. And this is also a foundation, as the Shaykh mentioned, derived from the Quran and the Sunnah, because when a person is unaware of who the scholars are, then they'll take their knowledge from just anyone, and it can lead to misguidance away from the foundation of the religion, which is the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But instead, you can end up being deviant and following the du'at ala abwab jahannam, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when he, in the hadith of Hudhayfa ibn Yaman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to describe those people Who are the du'at ala abwab of Jahannam? Who are the people who are calling to the path of Jahannam? And the Prophet ﷺ said they are from they're from our people, and they, you know, they speak our language. And so it shows us that knowledge and the people of knowledge, we must be aware of who they are so as not to follow the various paths which lead us away from the path of paradise, Sirat al-Mustaqim. So the Sheikh Muhammad Aman Ajami, rahimahullah ta'ala, said regarding this fundamental principle, he said, knowledge is a beloved characteristic. And likewise, ignorance is a negative attribute. So if you said to an ignorant common person, you are ignorant, he would become angry and displeased because he wants his ignorance to be hidden. Even if he does not possess knowledge, he can remedy his ignorance. If you said to him, you're a knowledgeable person, he would be happy even though he is ignorant. So of course, we know that is a well-known characteristic, that people are pleased with being considered a person of knowledge or being considered knowledgeable, regardless of their level of ignorance. But no one is pleased to be called an ignorant person, to be called someone who has nothing to offer as far as knowledge. So knowledge is a praiseworthy characteristic. And being amongst the people of knowledge is a great benefit from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, being from the people of knowledge refers to those people who have ilm nafiyah, meaning the people who have beneficial knowledge, which is knowledge of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and true fiqh, true understanding of the religion and jurisprudence. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man yuridullahu bihi khayran yafaqahu fid din." Whenever Allah is pleased with a person, He gives him understanding of the religion. And as the scholars mentioned, related to this hadith, that the mafhum of this hadith, or the understanding of this hadith, is that the person who is not blessed, has not been endowed with some knowledge of the religion, with an understanding of the religion, is not beloved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So a characteristic that Allah loves a person is that He gives him understanding of the religion. And vice versa, a characteristic that a person is not beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that they don't have that same position of being loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that they remain ignorant, and they remain in ignorance, and they go astray and they lead others astray. Sheikh Muhammad al-Jami, rahimahullah ta'ala, mentions three kinds of people regarding knowledge. First is the one who learns, and Allah grants him success, and accepts that knowledge, and he benefits him by practicing it. I mean, the knowledge, it benefits him, himself, by practicing it. Then he spreads that knowledge between people, and they benefit. His knowledge is accepted, and guidance and light, his knowledge and his guidance and the light is all accepted, and he benefited, and others benefited from his knowledge. So this is the first person with regards to knowledge. The second type of person is the one who studies, and he memorizes the Quran, and he memorizes books of the Sunnah, and he memorizes the names of the narrators of hadith, but he has little understanding of the religion and wisdom. And this goes back to the hadith we mentioned, مَنْ يُرَدُ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يَفَقَهُ فِي الدِّينِ, that whenever Allah wants good for a person, He gives him understanding of the religion. So you'll find people, and we've seen many people, who've memorized many, many hadith. They memorize books. They memorize the Quran. They maybe have qira'at. They have different ways of reciting the Quran. They have that. But their understanding of the religion is incorrect. Allah has not favored them with guidance and not favored them with true fiqh, because fiqh is true understanding of the religion. This is having the fiqh and having that basira. Some people, they have some knowledge, but they don't really know how to convey that knowledge. They don't know how to give dawah. They don't know the fiqh of dawah, you know, the understanding of dawah. They don't have the wisdom on how to deal with others and so forth. And some people are favored to have the tawfiq from Allah. And this is like the first person we mentioned. And this is the one that Allah has given them some knowledge. They practice that knowledge. and they benefit themselves by their practice, and they benefit others. The third person, the third type of person the Sheikh mentioned, he said the third type of person is the one who wastes his time, his or her time, does not benefit nor benefit others, and this is a characteristic, unfortunately, many Muslims possess. وَعِيَاذٍ بِاللَّهِ. The major scholars of Islam are characterized by the term Rabbaniyun. And then the Sheikh goes on to define what Rabbaniyun means. He says they are those who educate the small students with basic knowledge. Then they teach them in levels until they are grounded in understanding of the religion. So that's very, very important that we understand that when we say a scholar Rabbani, you know, he's an alim Rabbani. This means that he's a great scholar who is truly a true teacher, and that they teach people with the small issues before the big issues. And this is a good time to mention, and we see the problem when we have people who involve themselves in major issues without being grounded in the small issues. For example, we have individuals, they want to talk about jihad, they want to engage in jihad, they want to talk about issues of takfir, of declaring someone an apostate. They want to talk about major issues, major masail in the religion. But yet they don't know how to pray properly. They don't read Surah Al-Fatiha correctly. They want to talk about other major issues. They want to talk about Ahl al-Bid'ah. They want to criticize the people and be really strong in jar wa ta'dil, you know, in criticizing individuals and praising individuals. They want to be the one who people refer to. But those are major issues. Those are not issues that just the lay Muslim involves themselves in. But rather, those are for those people who are grounded in knowledge. So we see the harm that comes about when people engage in those bigger issues. Then they become misguided and they misguide others. For example, the recent issue with the individual which they claim that he was planning attacks on military installations in America and all kind of other activity. This comes from, for a person to even begin to get involved in this, we don't know whether these allegations are true or not, but just for a person to be any way associated with this kind of extremism shows their ignorance in the religion. It shows their ignorance and misguidance, that they've gone away from the true path of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and this comes from engaging in issues which you have no business engaging in, and not understanding even the small masail, the small issues. So Sheikh Muhammad Aman Ajami, rahimahullah ta'ala, said, be careful not to understand the term alim al-Rabbani, to misunderstand, or abd al-Rabbani, according to the misguided Sufi understanding. So the Sheikh is saying, be careful not to understand these terms by how the Sufis understand, some of those extreme Sufi groups. He says, so an abd al-Rabbani to the Sufis is the one who attains the level of knowledge in which he says something and it will happen, meaning that he has the ability to create. This is in accordance with their belief. They believe some individuals have gained such a level of knowledge or such a level of piety that they have the ability to create. And we know that this is false, and this is kufr al-akbar. This is the kind of disbelief that takes you out of the fold of Islam. Because we know Allah is al-Khaliq. Allah is the only one who creates. He's the only one who can say, be and it will be. So the Sheikh pointed out, he said the Sufis, they claim that there's individuals who attain the level in which he says something and it will happen. This is the misguided, astray, heretic Sufi understanding. So this is the understanding which is kufr al-akbar, which takes you out of the fold of religion. And he says, then whoever believes in that, and it is a level that is part of lordship, this is a part of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rububiyyah, to say something then it is, then this is calling to misguidance and to the shirk in lordship and worship together. So this means this is a violation of tawheed al-rububiyyah and tawheed al-uluhiyyah. This is a violation of the tawheed, the monotheism of lordship, and the monotheism of worship. Because this is claiming that these individuals have the ability to create and that they deserve extra respect and humility to the level of reverence of worship. And this is Kufr al-Akbar. This takes you out of the fold of Islam. And the Shaykh said, regardless of whether the one who propagates this understands this or not, meaning that the individual who believes this, who believes that other that people have the ability to create like this, and that they are worthy of worship or that they worship, regardless of whether they understand this principle, or the person that claims this about themselves, whether they understand this or not, they still are disbelievers. They still have left the fold of Islam for this misguided and serious violation of Tawheed, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qala Shaykh Muhammad rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, verily Allah has clarified this fundamental in the early part of the chapter of Surah Al-Baqarah, when he said, O children of Israel, remember my favor which I bestowed upon you and fulfill your obligations to my covenant with you, so that I fulfill my obligations to your covenant with me, and fear none but me, up to his saying, O children of Israel, remember my favor which I bestowed upon you, and that I preferred you to mankind and jinn. The Sheikh Muhammad Aman says, mentions that some of those scholars who are considered from the people of piety and knowledge, in fact, resembled the Jews and Christians. So he's saying that some of the people, for example, some of the Sufis, they say that certain scholars have reached such a level of knowledge, but you'll see certain characteristics about these individuals which are more in common with Jews and Christians than they are with Islamic scholars. And here's how. So the Sheikh said, so some of the people considered the people of piety and knowledge, in fact, resemble the Jews and Christians. He states, whoever worships Allah through ignorance, like the ignorance of the Sufis, resembles the Christians, because the Christians were misguided, so they were not people of knowledge. Okay? So, and this, how this resembles the Christians, because those people who are known for their worship, but who have little knowledge, those people are known for excessive worship in this community. Mostly were raised up under Sufi schools of thought and possess the characteristic of the Christians. For example, worship based upon ignorance, or worship based on blind following and resisting the people of knowledge. So, for example, you'll have individuals that they're known for their ibadah. They're in the front row in their prayers. They never miss prayer in the masjid. They are known for their piety and so forth. But they don't know anything about the religion. And they may even commit shirk al-akbar, you know, the major shirk that takes them out of the fold of Islam. Even though they pray, even though they make hajj, even though they fast, they may not have those things accepted by Allah, for one, because their aqidah takes them out of the fold of Islam. Number two, if their aqidah doesn't take them out of the fold of Islam, their belief, then it could be just because their ibadah, because it's not based on knowledge, they have so many mistakes. He doesn't pray correctly, he or she doesn't pray correctly, they don't fast correctly, they break their fast at any time because they don't have knowledge of the religion. This is why the importance of knowledge. So these people resemble, as Allah mentions in Surah Al-Fatiha, they resemble the Christians, in that the Christians were known for their worship. And even today you'll find many Christians, they're known for, some individuals go to church all the time. And they are known for, you know, giving a lot of charity to people. But you see, they don't even know much about their own faith. Even their own faith they don't know about. Why? Because they don't even study. They don't even study their own Bible. They abrogate the whole Old Testament. And then they also understand the New Testament by their own desires. Depends on their particular preacher. They just blind follow. If their preacher says homosexuality is okay today, then they accept that. If their preacher turns out to be a woman who wants to marry another woman, they accept that. When before, just yesterday, they didn't accept that. So it shows you that those people, they just blind follow and they operate on ignorance. And the Shaykh is pointing out that you have many Muslims and people who associate themselves with considered Muslim scholars or particular individuals of piety who resemble them. And then he mentions the second group, on the second group of individuals who resemble the Jews instead of the Christians. He said that these people, another group of so-called scholars, resembles the Jews, who had knowledge, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions us in the Quran, that they had knowledge. The Jews, they had knowledge of the religion, of the pure religion, of monotheism. But what? They did not practice it. So they were misguided. You know, they abrogated things. They added things. They made what was lawful unlawful and what was unlawful lawful. Okay? So this is a very dangerous thing. And the Sheikh says these so-called scholars, they resemble the Jews who had knowledge but did not practice it, so they were misguided. This was the characteristic of the children of Israel. And Allah admonished them often and said, "And do not mix the truth with falsehood, and do not conceal the truth, and you are aware of it." So they concealed the truth, and they mixed truth with falsehood in order to fit their desires. But the point being here is they did have knowledge of the truth. They just didn't practice it. So this is an incredibly dangerous characteristic. So this is a stern warning from Allah to make sure we practice the knowledge we have acquired about the religion, and that we seek knowledge to protect ourselves from misguidance. Sheikh Muhammad Aman al-Jami, rahimahullah ta'ala, mentioned the example of a misguided scholar who was asked about circumambulating around tombs, and replies that it is an expression of love for the pious. Or he is asked about supplicating or seeking intercession from dead saints, and he replies, it is from the expression of love for the righteous, and is not an act of shirk or polytheism. This is incredibly dangerous. So this means that you have some people who some people consider are people of knowledge. You know, you have people that are considered great Sufi sheikhs or great marid or whatever they call them, who they consider them people, great people of knowledge. And you ask, and the people ask for fatawa. They ask them about issues, about saying, hey, what about, you know, an individual might come to them and say, what about doing these dances or going around those tombs, around the grave sites? What about that? And he'll say, no, this is not worship. This is a way that we venerate or that we show respect to the saints, to the righteous people who died before us. And then they're asked about supplicating to those individuals. No. This is not shirk, or this is not worship, but rather we're showing respect because we're not clean enough in order to supplicate directly to Allah. This is the kind of thought that they have. And there's many people out there who give fatwa like this. And you just go, all you have to do is travel in almost any Muslim country and you'll find individuals who believe this. And we have this, of course, in the West as well. We have those individuals who've come to the West who have those deviant ideologies and commit shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they give fatwa without knowledge, and they misguide themselves and misguide others. As the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in a hadith about those who, that the people, one of the signs of the Day of Judgment is the people would take these people, they would take the ignorant for people of knowledge. And they would seek fatwa from them, and they would misguide themselves, or they would misguide others, and they would misguide themselves and be misguided. So this is an incredibly dangerous situation about dealing with people who may have some knowledge, or and they twist the truth. They mix truth with falsehood. They define worship, for example, as something different than Ahlus Sunnah defines it, something different than the Prophet ﷺ intended. Why? Because anytime someone tells you that it's okay to supplicate to the dead, it's okay to supplicate to the Prophet ﷺ, it's okay to supplicate to anyone besides Allah, know that this person is calling you to kufr, the disbelief that takes you out of the fold of Islam. Why is that? Because they are telling you that it's okay to supplicate to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they say that that's not worship. But what did the Prophet ﷺ say? He said, "A du'a huwa ibadah." He said, supplication is worship. This is a sahih, sound statement of the Prophet ﷺ, which shows us that supplication is worship. Supplication is worship. So, this is an incredibly dangerous thing that we don't want to resemble the Jews and the Christians regarding knowledge and not acting upon the religion or misguiding people with regards to the religion. Then the Sheikh went on to say, Rahimullah Ta'ala, he said, and what clarifies this even more is what the Sunnah has explained in so many different sayings that are obvious and clear to the common ignorant person. Afterwards, this fundamental became the strangest of matters. Likewise, the situation reached the point where knowledge and jurisprudence was considered as innovations and misguidance. And the best argument they have is mixing the truth with falsehood. The situation reached the point where those deviants claim the knowledge which Allah the Almighty praised and made obligatory upon the creation is not spoken about except by someone who is an atheist or a crazy person. And whoever disputes this point and opposes it and writes books warning against it and prohibiting it, meaning prohibiting knowledge, he is considered a scholar of jurisprudence. What is the point here? The point here meaning that the people became so misguided that some people consider deviance to be right guidance. And they consider, for example, shirk to be tawheed, you know, to be polytheism, to be monotheism. And misguidance to be guidance. The sunnah to be bid'ah. This is how misguided the people became with regards to knowledge. So then it came to such a level that there are individuals out there, and this is especially in the time of Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, as he's explaining, because this is his treatise, that some of the people, the knowledge that Allah said was an obligation upon us to seek, that some of the individuals in that time were saying no, that if you seek this knowledge, you're actually crazy, or you are zindiq, you are basically an apostate or a heretic, but rather, you shouldn't seek correct knowledge from the Qur'an and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, but rather you should blind follow maybe these sheikhs or whatever. Just trust in them. Put your religion and your trust in them, and this is how you'll have success. This is how misguided the people became. So that was the fourth fundamental. Moving on, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said the fifth fundamental, so the fifth principle. He said, clarification from Allah, the one free of all imperfections, concerning the friends of Allah and his distinguishing between them and those who emulate them from among the enemies of Allah, the hypocrites and the wicked ones. And it is sufficient the verse of Surah Ali Imran when he says, say, O Muhammad, if indeed you love Allah, then you must follow me and Allah will love you. Also, an ayah of Surah Al-Ma'idah, which is a saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, O you who believe, whoever amongst you turns back from his deen, then Allah will bring in their place a people whom he will love and they will love him. Those are the signs of the awliya. Those are the signs of the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, in the verse in Surah Yunus, is a saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, indeed, the friends of Allah, they shall have no fear, nor shall they grieve. They are those who believe and observe piety. So there, right there, it mentions some of the characteristics of the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is one, that they have no fear, they shall have no fear, nor shall they grieve. They don't become sad and excessively depressed and so forth. Why? Because they have taqwa. They believe in Allah. They put their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those are some of the signs and characteristics of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the situation, the Shaykh wanted to say, then the situation reached the point where most of those who claim to have knowledge and be guiders of the creation and claim to be of the protectors of divine law must be of those who abandon following of the messengers to be considered supporters of Allah. And to those who are misguided, whoever follows the messengers is not one of the supporters of Allah. And it is also essential to abandon fighting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sake. So they abandon jihad. This is what those people call to. And whoever performs it, meaning jihad, it is not one of the supporters of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are what these people claim. They go so far from the religion that they twist, you know, when a person strives for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they say that that's misguided. That this person, no. They're on misguidance. You know, they, and any of the characteristics of the Oliyah, of the true Oliyah, they negate those characteristics. In addition, it is imperative to abandon faith and piety, according to these people. And whoever commits himself to observing faith and piety, meaning iman and taqwa, is not considered one of the supporters of Allah. O our Lord, we seek your pardon and well-being. So the Shaykh here was just saying, he was mentioning, that the affair became twisted. That some of the people, they became so misguided that they slander and attack the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and claim that the friends of Allah, those people who practice those characteristics that Allah has mentioned in the Quran, that those people are in fact misguided. And they have many of their own criterion in which they consider to be a friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like you'll hear a lot of people, they'll claim they're Sufi sheikhs, are awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They say, hey, these people have gotten to such a level in ibadah and worship that they don't have to worship Allah anymore. That they've gotten to such a level of piety that all you have to do is they no longer have to worship. They don't have to pray anymore. Either they've become one with Allah, or they are Allah, or Allah is a part of them, or etc. They have many deviant beliefs. And there's another group amongst them who believes that being a friend of Allah is something that you inherit. So-and-so Sheikh so-and-so was a righteous person, and this is his son. So he is a friend of Allah as well. Or this person has a descendant of the Prophet ﷺ, so he's a friend of Allah. No. That friend of Allah is something not inherited. And it's something, it doesn't have anything to do with your race. It's not because you're Saudi. It's not because you're Arab. It's not because you're Somali. It's not because you're American. Not because your passport is this. No. You don't get a direct card to Jannah like this. No. But rather, it is those characteristics of worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on ikhlas and following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and having piety and having those characteristics that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned throughout the Quran and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, a person who is considered a friend of Allah, a servant who loves Allah, loves his religion, glorifies Allah, glorifies his commands, submits to him, submits to his legislation, and he humbles himself before him. Those are characteristics of the awliya. That's a person who is a friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they glorify Allah. They glorify his religion. They love Allah. They submit to him and his commands. And they submit to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This relationship with Allah is something that is earned from our good deeds and possessing those characteristics that Allah loves. Allah says, as was reported by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, my servant does not come closer to me with anything more beloved to me than what I have made obligatory upon him. Meaning, doing the obligatory acts is a way to be loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, this is what Allah said in accordance with, as was reported by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Hadith al-Qudsi, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, my servant does not come closer to me with anything more beloved to me than what I've made obligatory upon him. So, meaning doing the obligatory things, just guarding your salat and guarding it correctly, meaning that you practice the wajibat of salat. You know, you meet the conditions for salat, and you meet those the pillars of prayer and all the other actions, and you perfect them. This alone will make you a friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And fasting, you do it based on knowledge. So if you learn your prayer, learn fasting, learn those obligatory actions and practice them, this will help you be an awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then doing the nawafil, doing the extra prayer and the extra fasting and the extra acts of worship, these will help you. All of this, you'll get ajr from this. And another way, by seeking the knowledge, is a very important act of worship that Allah loves. So by seeking knowledge for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're coming closer to Allah, and you can be one of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Talib al-ilm, you know, someone who's sincerely a student of knowledge, and someone who is a scholar in Islam, they are some of the closest friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because they're doing one of the greatest acts of worship, which is seeking knowledge. Seeking knowledge of what? Of chemistry and building bridges? No, that's something, mashallah, beneficial. But they're seeking ilm al-nafi, which the scholars refer to beneficial knowledge as knowledge of the religion, knowledge of the sharia, knowledge of what is halal and what's haram. And this will bring us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as the Salaf, the pious predecessors, they used to say, talib al-ilm, talib al-jannah, that the student of knowledge is a student of paradise. The seeker, and you could maybe translate, say, the seeker of knowledge is the seeker of paradise. So that's what really talib al-ilm is. Why? Because they were really sincere about knowledge. But we like to get be called the talib al-ilm as a title. MashaAllah, so-and-so went to Yemen. So-and-so went to Saudi. So-and-so went to Mauritania. He went to Sudan. She went to Indonesia. And they learned the Quran. And they learned fiqh. And why? Because to be known as a talib al-ilm. But instead, our intention should be to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and correct our worship and come closer to Him, and then we'll be rewarded from that. And going back to the issue at hand, and can be one of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be one of the friends of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Shaykh Muhammad Aman rahimahullah ta'ala explains that this means, this hadith that we mentioned, hadith al-Qudsi, that this means all of the actions in belief Allah has prescribed for us, and avoiding those things He has forbidden. This is what we mean by, doing those obligatory things. Doing all the actions and beliefs that Allah has prescribed for us. Meaning Tawheed, we have to have correct Tawheed. We can't say, oh, Allah is everywhere, or Allah is, we believe in some of His names and attributes, but we don't believe in others. We can't do that. We can't distort His name. We can't say no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ar-Rahman ala arsh istawa. You know, Ar-Rahman, the most merciful, He rose above His throne. But we can't say, no, that means power. Or no, it means He took the throne by force, istola. No, it means this. No, it means that. No. We have to define it as the Salaf defined it, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Sahaba, radiallahu ta'ala anhum, understood it. This is the completeness of Islam. And this is how, so when we understand the religion in accordance with our beliefs and our actions are doing the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and staying away from those things He subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited, this is how we can be an awliya of Allah. This is how we can be one of the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And going on to the sixth fundamental, the last fundamental that the Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned, he said the sixth fundamental. He said the sixth fundamental is a refutation of the doubtful issues that has been contrived by the shaitan concerning the abandonment of the Qur'an and the Sunnah by following the various opinions and desires. So there was a shubahat going around in the time of the shaykh, and still goes around, very much so, where individuals believe that we should, and this comes from the shaitan, that, hey, why are you following the Qur'an and the Sunnah? Why not follow so-and-so's opinion? Why not just follow your desires? I mean, you have Muslims now, you know, Muslim women, even in the Muslim lands, in places where they can learn Islam easily, who say, no, hijab is probably a choice. It's not wajib. Or, you know, women, we have these additional rights that Allah has not legislated. You know, Allah has said this, but we think we have this right. Or we should be above the men in this situation or that situation. And you have other individuals who are just pure secularists, and then they still consider themselves Muslim. They say, hey, we're Muslim, but we don't believe in the Sharia. We're Muslim, we don't think you should ever rule by Allah's law, whether you're in a Muslim country or a non-Muslim country. You have people who have names like Muhammad and Fatima and Tariq, and things like this, who believe this. They believe that actually Islam is just something in name. You know, and that, you know, that they're glad that they're living in a non-Muslim land because they don't like the Sharia. So these people, they rule by what? They rule by their desires. They don't rule by the Quran and the Sunnah. And they discourage people from going back to the Quran and Sunnah. They don't want to. This is a very dangerous thing. Some people, they worship, literally they worship democracy. That is their God. And they take that above what? They take that above the Qur'an and the Sunnah. They don't believe in the Qur'an and the Sunnah. Instead, they say, no, hey, This is the 20th century, 21st century. We don't have to, you don't have to wear hijab. You don't have to have any of the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't have to do this. Hey, that was way back then. That was way back then that you should grow your beard. That was way back then that you had to, that you have to believe in such and such. Now we should believe that we are one faith. I mean, with everyone, the Hindus, the Sikhs, all of us, you know, we are all one faith. You know, we're one faith. Allah says, Ahle Kitab, the Jews and the Christians. So that means we should all sit together and propagate together our religion. Our religion is one. This is what some of the people believe. And these people, they rule by their desires. But they don't go back to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, which shows us and gives us the instructions on how to do all to practice our daily lives and to practice the religion. So, and it is the Shaykh went on to say, and it is that the Quran and the Sunnah cannot be known to anyone except the mujtahid scholar who is not restricted to a methodology in deriving legal rulings. So these people, they claim, and this is according from the Shaytan has whispered to them, that only, that no one can understand the Quran and the Sunnah. This is what they believe. That only a major, major scholar who has the right to make jurisprudence rulings and fatwa is the only one who can understand the Quran and the Sunnah. So in fact, you should abandon reading it. There are some individuals who have reached this level of misguidance. That they actually believe that you should not read the Quran and the Sunnah and learn, and yet you can't understand anything of the religion from the Quran and the Sunnah, but you have to instead go to one of these major, major scholars and blindly follow them, and that is the way to paradise. But that's a major, major mistake which leads to misguidance and leads to the hellfire. And then the Shaykh went on to say, and such a mujtahid, you know, such a person who's on this level in knowledge, is described with such qualifications that might not even be found fully in Abu Bakr and Umar, radiallahu anhum. Radiallahu anhuma. May Allah be pleased with all the Sahaba, radiallahu anhum. So some of these people, they claim to such a level, they're on such misguidance, that they believe that in order to understand the Quran and the Sunnah, that you have to have more knowledge than Abu Bakr and Umar. That, and those are the most knowledgeable people of the of Islam after the Prophet ﷺ, was Abu Bakr and Umar and all the Sahaba, radiallahu anhu, because they were there when the revelation was being revealed. They were the most knowledgeable. Abu Bakr is the most knowledgeable of the Ummah. He was the most knowledgeable, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And this is a very dangerous shubha, a very dangerous, doubtful issue. The Shaykh went on to say, rahimahullah ta'ala, consequently, if a person is not qualified to this level, then it is absolutely obligatory for him to turn away from these two sources, meaning the Quran and the Sunnah, there being no doubt or ambiguity about the matter. This is what they believe. They believe that if you haven't reached this major level of being able to give fatwa and go to the Quran and Sunnah and make jurisprudence rulings by yourself, if you haven't reached that level, then you need to abandon the Quran and the Sunnah in totality. It's hard for us to imagine this kind of belief in our time, but during the Sheikh's time especially, this was something which was widespread, as this is why he emphasized this foundation, and it is derived from the Quran and the Sunnah. All throughout the Quran and the Sunnah, it refutes this. So it shows that people hold this type of mentality as if you cannot understand the Quran and the Sunnah at all. So hence, whoever seeks true guidance from these two sources is either a heretic in their eyes, in these deviants, they think that they're a disbeliever, or a crazy person due to the difficulty of understanding these two sources. There's some individuals, they believe you're crazy, or you're an apostate if you think that you can actually understand the Quran and the Sunnah by yourself at all. Instead, they say, no, you got to blind follow, that's it. And Allah is free of all imperfections and worthy of praise. Consider how much Allah has refuted clearly this accursed doubt. Through that which He has legislated, and through that which He has decreed, and through that which He has created, and through that which He has commanded, Allah has clarified this issue in various ways, such that it has reached the point of essential knowledge which must be known to the general people. Yet in spite of that, most people do not know. Allah says, indeed the word of punishment has proved true against most of them, so they will not believe. Verily, we have put on their necks iron collars, reaching to the chins, so that their heads are raised up. And we have put a barrier between before them and a barrier behind them, and we have covered them up, so that they cannot see. It is the same to them whether you warn them or you warn them not. They will not believe. You can only warn him who follows the reminder, the Quran, and fears the most gracious, Allah the unseen. So give him the glad tidings of forgiveness and general reward. So Allah is giving glad tidings to the one who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and who, will not be of the people of the hellfire and who follows the Quran. And you can only follow the Quran by what? By learning. So you can read the Quran and read the authentic sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and gain understanding. Doesn't mean you're going to be a scholar or even a student of knowledge. But everyone, Allah has made the Quran so that everyone can derive, the general meanings and rulings and the commands. They can derive the general things which are halal and haram. It doesn't take being a major scholar to know that. So this is a very incredibly important principle to know that we need to read and strive to remove the ignorance from us, and that we shouldn't blind follow. We should be careful of taqlid and blind following anyone, but rather strive to gain knowledge and seek, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَلَ أَهْلِ ذِكْرٍ كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. You know, ask the people of knowledge if you do not know. So if you do not know, ask the people of knowledge. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us. فَسْأَلَ أَهْلِ ذِكْرٍ كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. نعم, إِنْ كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. So if you are unaware, Allah has given a command here. Ask the people of knowledge if you do not know. But if you know, if it's something general in the religion, you don't have to ask every single question. You know, Shaykh, is water pure or not? Okay, Shaykh, do I have to have wudu before Salat? Do I have to purify myself before Salat? No, you should know this. So if it's something that you are aware of, that you have knowledge about, you don't need to ask. But those issues which you do not know about, ask the people of knowledge. But we should be cautious about blindly following anyone in belief in anything. It's an obligation upon us to ta'allam, to learn. As the Shaykh mentioned in many of his other treaties, for example, in Al-Usul al-Thalatha, he said, اِعْلَمُوا رَحِمَكَ اللَّهُ أَنَّهُ يَجِبُ عَلَيْنَا تَعَلَّمَ رَبَعَ مَسَائِلَ الْأُولَى الْعِلْمِ. He said, know, and may Allah have mercy upon you. That is an obligation upon every Muslim to know four things. He said, Al-Ula al-Ilm. He said, the first thing is knowledge. And then he defined what knowledge is. Ma'rufat Allah, ma'rufat Nabi, ma'rufat Deen al-Islam bi-Adillah. He said, the first thing that you must know as a Muslim is you must have knowledge of Allah. And you must have knowledge of His Prophet. And you must have knowledge of the religion of Islam with the textual proof. And that's a beautiful faida and very relevant to what we're saying here. Why? Because here we're talking about not blindly following, and that you have the ability to know something from the Quran and the Sunnah. Doesn't mean you're going to make fatwa, but you can practice the Quran and the Sunnah. You can practice it. You know, there's enough literature out there, even in our language and English, that we can learn a lot about the religion. But to take it to the next level before you're going to really be a student of knowledge, and it's definitely a sheikh, you got to know Arabic. Okay, but there's so many things translated out there now that we can all gain a lot of benefit about the basis of our religion and even more. SubhanAllah. So the relevance here is when the Shaykh said, when he mentioned those three things, when he defined knowledge as knowing Allah, knowing the Messenger, and knowing the religion of Islam with its textual proofs. Not by knowing the religion of Islam by your Shaykh, by your madhab, by your methodology, by your minhaj, no. But knowing it by what? By the textual proofs, by going back to the nusus. Going back to what are the nusus? They're the Quran, and they're the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So, by knowing Allah, the only way you're going to know Allah, it isn't by meditating. There's no one who's going to be just born, and they're going to meditate, and they're going to know who Allah is. No. They're going to be misguided. Even those people who had knowledge about the Quran, and maybe even some knowledge about the Sunnah before, some of the early sects, they went misguided, they meditated excessively, and involved with philosophy. So then they went misguided so much so that they believed they either became Allah, or they became one with Allah, or they didn't need Allah anymore. Because they mix philosophy with Islam and they meditate. They say, hey, I'm going to leave the Quran and the Sunnah for a while. And I'm just going to contemplate Allah. But the only way you know Allah is from the Quran and the Sunnah. That's the only way. The way you receive, as many of our scholars, but just recently I was listening, and Sheikh Abdullah Bukhari, Hafidhullah Ta'ala, was mentioning that the asal of the Muslim is jahil. That the Muslim, the foundation of the Muslim is ignorance. Why? Because you have to ta'allam. You have to learn. We know Allah by learning about Islam, by reading the Quran and the Sunnah. You're not going to learn it by just sitting and meditating. And we learn about the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. We don't just know it just because you memorize the Quran. No, you have to read the Sunnah. And you have to sit in lectures. You have to sit in durus from the students of knowledge or from the scholars to learn about the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And you have to read all of those things. It's input. If you want data, correct data output, you have to input data. And how do we input it? By reading and taking it in through our senses. But it's not just by contemplating. It's not meditating and doing yoga poses and then we're going to get revelation. No. Instead, we have to learn. We have to seek knowledge. And the way we're going to know Islam and to know Islam correctly based on the Quran and the Sunnah is by going to the Quran and the Sunnah. And reading the Quran and the Sunnah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's the only way we're going to learn it. It isn't through the revelation is ended. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the last prophet and messenger sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. So we have to go back to the Quran and the Sunnah. And the Shaykh ended by saying, in the end, the praise belongs to Allah, the Lord of the worlds, and may the praise of Allah and peace and safety be upon our leader Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and upon his family and companions until the day of judgment. So, again, this is incredibly important to make sure that we benefit from these six foundations. First, beginning with having sincerity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, having ikhlas lillah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our worship. And the second thing is by avoiding separation. You know, having unity, striving for unity in the community. And it's a command from Allah all throughout the Quran and the Sunnah to be unified and stay away from divisions. Stay away from those things, the divisions. And also remembering that unification or unity in the religion can only come from one thing. It doesn't come from a new democratic understanding. It doesn't come from a communistic orientation. It doesn't come from a socialist paradigm. But instead it comes from what? It comes from unifying on the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Unlike those people who claim, like Ikhwan al-Muslimin, who want to, for example, now in Egypt, they're trying to establish a new coalition. So they're having a coalition with secularists, maybe even with, Egyptian gay rights groups, and all these coalitions. But yet they're supposed to be an Islamic party. Absolutely not. That's not Islam. So unity is something that is an obligation in the religion, but not by any means necessary. Unity can only be based on the Quran and the Sunnah and the understanding of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, radiyallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in. And the third principle, the third foundation, was hearing and obeying the leaders and not revolting against them. And the fourth principle, which we covered today, was the clarification of who, of what knowledge is and who the scholars are. And not to resemble and not to follow deviant scholars who resemble the people of misguidance. And the fifth principle, as we mentioned, was that the clarification that Allah clarified all throughout the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who the awliya, who his friends are. And the distinction between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's friends and those and the friends of the shaitan, in fact. Those people who call you to shirk and kufr and disbelief and zandaka, those people are the awliya of shaitan. They are the friends of shaitan. But the friends of Allah call you to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They call you to worship Him and Him alone. And they follow His commands. And they follow the commands of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they stay away from the things that will lead you away from those commands. And the last principle, as we just mentioned, is a refutation, which is contained in the Quran and the Sunnah, of the doubtful thing that the shaitan has put in the minds and hearts of many of the Muslims, that they should now leave the Quran and the Sunnah and return instead to their own desires or blind following individuals or other ways of ruling their lives instead of going back to the pristine essence of the religion, which is based on the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I ask Allah the Almighty to accept our good and forgive our evil. And anything I said that was correct was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And anything I said that was incorrect was from myself and the shaitan. وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه